Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Ms. Demeanor, a novel by Elinor Lipman, performed by Piper Goodeve. To the memory of Maymeeve Medwed, beloved best friend and most charitable critic. Chapter 1. Regrettably. Let's say there were two people, a man and a woman, lounging on the rooftop terrace of an apartment building in Midtown Manhattan. She is 39, a lawyer. He, on the neighboring chaise longue, is 27, a new associate in the same firm, who has this night confessed to a crush that was not brushed aside, as workplace guidelines required. We'll call him Noah, and we'll call her me. It's barely our first date, after a less than professional conversation in a long checkout line at Trader Joe's. We have a drink or two at a nearby Mexican restaurant. We return to my building, specifically for me to show off its newest and proudest amenity, our tiled, furnished, and landscaped roof, with its view of Central Park one way and Times Square blinking to the south. It is a June night, with ideal 75-ish degree breezes blowing. Above us was not just a full moon, but a blood moon, huge and red. Man, woman, mojitos. One thing leads to another, just the way Miss Freitas warned in junior high sex ed. It is past the hour at which the building lights automatically go off. Noah asks, after a long companionable silence on our separate chaises, "Did you ever skinny dip?" It is, I assume, a purely academic question, since there is no pool in my building. I say, once or twice. He then asks, "Do other people use the roof this late?" I tell him I don't know. This is the latest I've ever been up here. "No pressure," he assures me. "But do you mind if I take my clothes off? The breeze is beautiful. It'll be like moonbathing." I don't object. Workplace ethics aside, who wouldn't be a little curious, given what sounded like anatomical pride? And who would know? I could hear the squeak of the chaise as he lifted his butt, presumably to peel off whatever, if any, underwear a 27-year-old wears. I say, if anyone at work ever found out, "I'm not stupid, no one ever will." And then, "It feels great. It's like the breezes are massaging me. If I fall asleep, wake me when you want me to leave." What could be more benign than that? No agenda, no pressure, no suggestion that I, too, might enjoy these tickling breezes on parts rarely exposed to the elements. After a few more minutes, I volunteer, "Maybe just my dress."
"Totally up to you."
What makes my disrobing a bigger leap than I might otherwise have undertaken is that this halter dress is equipped with an interfacing that imparts built-in support. In other words, I am braless. Why be a prude? The Eagle Scout's eyes aren't even open. There I lie, my dress bunching around my waist, more suitable for a mammogram than moonbathing. It takes some sashaying in place, but I work everything down and off. Everything. Proving I am just as much a cool and carefree exhibitionist as any overly handsome associate a dozen years my junior. Now what? Sit back and mimic his atmospheric gusto? I hear, "Better not look," followed by, "Sorry." I do look. Even in the dark, I can see his two hands trying to conceal a bobbing penis. Not unflattered, I say, "It's not doing anyone any harm." We are both silent until I ask, "Would you like me to touch it?" Then we are, now side by side on one narrow chaise, hip to hip. Did I not know fully that our kissing would make his condition more acute? I say, "Maybe we should go downstairs to my apartment."
"Are you cold?"
I say, "No, hardly. I meant it would just be more comfortable. Just for, never mind, don't stop." The exceedingly polite Noah asks with every advance,
"Are you sure?"
Having broken my own loose rule about no sex until the fifth date, maybe second, third, or fourth, depending, I intended to comply with the firm's sexual harassment guidelines. Tomorrow, first thing, I'd disclose to HR in the strictest confidence that Noah and I had seen each other outside the office. Yes, maybe news of social note delivered ex post facto, but disclosure nonetheless. Easy, no worries. I was wrong, very, because across the street, from a comparable elevation, a law and order prude of a mother superior couldn't take her eyes off us. She called 911, sounding frantic over a crime taking place directly opposite her, in public. She was appalled, disgusted, shocked. She was shaking. Send someone. When the police arrived and asked, "What do you want us to do?" she could have said, "Just tell them never to do it again." But no, she wanted us arrested. She'd seen our private parts. And here, if the officers didn't believe her, the video on her phone. Is this not indecent exposure? Is this not lewd and lascivious behavior? The officers crossed the street, badged my overnight doorman, asked if he could identify either of these people from the video, now transferred to their phones. Whatever Andre said, maybe, hard to tell with them moving, I think it's Miss Morgan in 6J. Up they went to the roof, knocked on the door, announced, "Police!" As we scrambled for our clothes, I yelled, "Give us a sec, I'm fine, we're on a date." And when we were both covered and upright, "Okay, you can come in now." They did. A man and a woman, unsmiling, both short, both solid. Noah volunteered, "If you need me to leave so she can confirm that she's safe and this is all consensual." Both officers, I thought, were looking more apologetic than constabular. "No," said the male officer. "We're following up on a 911 call about a crime in progress." I told them I was a lawyer. What crime? "Indecent exposure." Then quietly, "Exposing genitals to the public." "This is private property, a co-op. I own shares in this building." He looked skyward.
"Open air, exposed. The victim was able to videotape you. It's as good as a public place."
I said, "Victim? Isn't being a peeping Tom a crime? I'll countersue."
"We're obliged to follow up, ma'am," he said. "It's about the victim's mindset. To her, it was a shock."
"She had palpitations," said his partner. "Where is she?" I asked. But it was obvious, surveilling us from the terrace directly across 7th Avenue, with its show-off potted plants and trellises decorated for every stupid holiday. I might as well have streaked down 5th Avenue. In the wattage of a full moon, we'd committed a lewd public act or two, considered by the traumatized killjoy across the street as gross indecency and putting on a show. The summons brought us a day in court. Represented by a senior member of my firm, Noah was fined, but didn't lose his entry-level job. I, a litigator, represented myself, sure that any judge would find that two consenting adults having sex on private property had done no one any harm. During my allocution, pre-sentencing, I couldn't bring myself to apologize. I suggested that what happened on my terrace happened all over the city, all over the country, weather permitting, between consenting adults.
"Does that make it right?"
the judge asked.
"Her grandchildren could have been visiting."
For my gross indecency, my apparent lack of remorse, and unstated promiscuity, for workplace sexual harassment, not even charged but implied, for the grainy photo published in the New York Post identifying me with the suffix JD, he made an example of lawless me, an officer of the court. He imposed a fine of $2,000 and 180 freaking days of home confinement. 3 already miserable weeks later, I received a letter of censure from the Bar Association, with a notice that my hard-earned, income-granting, pride-affirming license to practice law had been suspended. Chapter 2. It begins. Who didn't suggest that I view my sentence as a sabbatical, a much-needed rest from briefs and deadlines and clients, Would they like to try 6 months off without travel or passport, without weekends away or nights out, with the only fresh air available from the roof that was the scene of their crime? If I heard a note of disapproval in anyone's helpful hint, I'd nip it in the bud. Bad behavior or just bad luck? Yes, I may have been having sex al fresco with someone, heaven forfend, I wasn't married to, but it's not a crime per se until observed by someone with a 911 trigger-happy finger. Doesn't your building have a gym? Was a favorite palliative. It did, but only someone with the whole city at his or her disposal would consider an in-house gym to be a substitute for real life. I made a list of might-do activities I could perform solo indoors. Read books, watch the TV series that everyone had discussed with passion in the firm's break room, learn to play an instrument, keep a journal, meditate, do jigsaw and crossword puzzles, relearn to knit, hook a rug, needlepoint a pillow, paint, write letters, write a novel, write poems, cook, bake, feed a sourdough starter. The culinary activities were inspired by my state-of-the-art kitchen, no credit to me, but to the previous owner's expensive choices. Those generous for Manhattan 100 square feet of kitchen were what gave my sister ideas on how to keep me busy. The word sister not telling the whole story, because we are identical twins. Jane Morgan, JD, and Jacqueline Morgan, MD, a dermatologist with a flourishing solo practice on the Upper East Side. A factor in her efforts to support me was her belief that she was partially responsible for my home confinement, having attended my hearing for moral support, dressed in a red suit and a feathered black fascinator, sitting directly and identically behind me, glaring at the judge. Might he have noticed? She asked. I knew her. I heard her self-blame not as guilt over her courtroom behavior, but as her lifelong belief that she is the center of attention, that the male judge couldn't help but notice her, intuit her judicial animus, and punish the nearest defendant for it. My parents and I don't know why Jacqueline sees herself as the more important, grander twin. Is it nomenclature? Me, Jane, she, Jacqueline. Jacqueline on her birth certificate, shortened and made cuter in high school. True, she's a doctor, but I'm a lawyer. We earned the same ribbons in high school sports and went to the same college. As to her airs of superiority and her bossiness, when challenged, she doesn't know what I'm talking about. But my bad luck has brought out the best in Jacqueline. Without mentioning money, without asking me directly how I was paying my bills, she was finding ways to underwrite my unemployed existence. It wasn't the unvarnished writing of checks, but support both subtle and unsubtle, literal and figurative. She is ambitious on my behalf, and with her practice thriving, she is generous. So generous that I've stopped mentioning things I want or need, her retention so good that the book or earrings or slow cooker I've admired show up within days. I don't love being a charity case, but having turned myself into an unemployed outlaw, I'm in no position to reject her noblesse oblige. And the friends with all the suggestions about how to fill my hours, who might visit or send a note, a book, a bottle of wine, where are they now? Since the first week of my confinement, Jacqueline and I talked daily and have a standing Sunday night dinner, always her treat, a bounty of extras delivered so I'll have leftovers. The day she suggested we forego our usual takeout, I sensed she was up to something and asked why. She missed my cooking. Why order in when we could have one of my brilliant meals? More transparent compliments followed. What I produced was creative and delicious, and my gorgeous kitchen. Was I using it to its full capacity? She wished her kitchen had that double oven, these six burners, that trash compactor. I said, but you never cook. You keep boxes of shoes in your oven. What's really up? She said, I have an idea. I'll tell you over dinner tomorrow. Order anything and everything you want, she said. Her fresh direct password texted as we spoke. I was susceptible. I had no income. I paid my maintenance and utilities from savings, didn't want to touch my 401k or take handouts from my parents. Sunday night arrived with the many indulgences I'd ordered, starting with live Maine lobsters. She complimented every morsel, the salad with its radishes and heirloom tomatoes, the corn, the melted butter, the reduced-fat Cape Cod potato chips. She praised not just...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.